السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praises due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His final messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Today, inshallah, will be the start of Juz Tabarak, and we will be starting with the first chapter, Tabarak الذي بيده الملك. And subhanallah, this is one of the chapters. Surat Tabarak is one of those chapters that has significant importance to a Muslim. That is why of the virtues of Surat Tabarak is a person whoever reads Surat Tabarak every night. Some hadith say that this chapter, this surah, will intercede for him. And also another hadith, when we mentioned the Day of Judgment, when we mentioned the torment of the grave, there's a hadith that said whoever reads Surah Tabarak every night, he will be protected from the torment of the grave. So Surah Tabarak, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to keep on reciting this because it's a good reminder. Subhanallah, it has signs, benefits for those who have open hearts, who have eyes that they clearly see and ears that ponder. It has great benefits for a Muslim. And we start the start of this chapter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. From the word tabarak, we understand that all blessings are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All blessings start from Allah. So there is nothing blessed except the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made blessed. There is no blessings by itself except that Allah has blessed. So for those who are seeking blessings, we seek blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. True barakah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made causes for this barakah, and He made some things filled with barakah. Yeah? But that is why it is important to understand that it's not up to us to make things a source of barakah. We go to the Quran and Sunnah, and there we find what are the sources of barakah. For example, if we find some people rubbing a certain tree or a certain rock, we say to them, they say, well, we take barakah from this. We say, okay, fine. Do you have a clear text from the Quran and Sunnah? If yes, then yes, it is a source of barakah. They will say, no, there is no Quran and Sunnah. We say, then okay, fine. Then why are you claiming that this is a source of barakah? Barakah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? And claiming that something is a source of barakah, which Allah did not make a source of blessings, is considered a big sin. It's considered a grave sin. And from this, the Prophet ﷺ, even the Prophet ﷺ, he was really angry regarding a matter similar to this. You know the famous hadith when one of the companions, he said that when they were traveling, I think it was for jihad, they saw some of the trees that the disbelievers used to hang their weapons. So they said to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, اجعل لنا ذات أنواط كما أن لهم ذات أنواط. What does ذات أنواط mean? ذات أنواط, the disbelievers, they used to have this belief that if they tied their weapons to a certain tree, that these weapons will be blessed from this tree. So the Prophet ﷺ got extremely angry. It's not easy to get the Prophet angry. Remember the story where the man urinated in Masjid? The companions got angry. The Prophet ﷺ, you know, was calm. He said, no, leave him. When he finishes, okay, when he finished, then he poured some water over the urine. But at the end of the day, he wasn't angry. He just explained it. In this hadith, he was furious. ﷺ. Why? Because we are crossing our boundaries. Because now this is, you're entering something very dangerous, claiming that something's a source of barakah. It will lead you to worshipping it. So what happens is that the Prophet ﷺ said, what you have just said is like what the people of Moses, the companions, said to him. اجعل لنا آلهة كما لهم آلهة. So let's, that when they worship the cow. So they wanted something to worship. So subhanAllah. That's why the Prophet ﷺ was extremely angry in these matters. So we understand that, you know, this is a serious matter. Purifying one's belief is something very important. Do not follow folk taste. Do not act on ignorance. Educate yourself. Matters of barakah is also part of the religion. There are rulings, just like salah, there are rulings. We go back to the Quran and Sunnah. There are conditions, there are preferred actions, there are sunan. The same thing with these matters. Barakah and all of this, there are rulings, yeah? So we have to educate ourselves and seek proper knowledge. Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. Biyadihi al-mulk, the one who owns dominion. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one true ruler of this whole world. Even what we own, we don't really fully own it. We're restricted with what we do. For example, if someone has some wealth, if he says, "Ya akhi, I'm free to do whatever I want, I can take my wealth and burn it," he's not free. This is considered a sin, and he'll be accountable for that which he did. He's not free. Yes, it's yours, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave you permission to act and for it to be under your command. Otherwise, it's for Allah. Allah is the true ruler. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. And also, since He is the one who truly controls the world, He subhanahu wa ta'ala commands with whatever He wills. Nobody adjusts His command. لا معقب لأمره لحكمه. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He commands, no one can interfere. No messenger, no angel, no one. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted good with someone, no one can interfere. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hated someone because of his actions and wanted to punish him, no one can interfere, except with the permission of Allah. So why, subhanAllah, depend on, you know, someone or something, angels or messengers, when you can khalas, go directly to Allah? And this is what La ilaha illallah means. And by the way, this is just one piece of information for you. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, the closest companions to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how many times did they ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was alive? When he was alive, how many times did they ask him to make dua? Think about it. You will never find any hadith that one of these four, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, has ever asked the Prophet ﷺ to make dua for him. Why? Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah has mentioned this. He said because their faith was so high and they understood that even these things, they directly asked Allah, even though it's permissible. It's permissible if they ask the Prophet ﷺ to make dua, and of course his dua will be accepted. Even these things, these small things, because of their love of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, because they followed the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ sincerely and worshipping Allah sincerely, their hearts was pure with La ilaha illallah. They truly understood this religion. They didn't even go to the Prophet ﷺ. And you know the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ has commanded Umar, he said when Uwais al-Qarni will arrive, there's a man from the He will arrive to you from Yemen. His name is Uwais. Ask him to make dua for you. Now, who is better in position? Uwais or Umar ibn al-Khattab? In agreement, there is no doubt. Umar ibn al-Khattab, of course. Umar ibn al-Khattab is ranked number two of all this nation. No one is better than Umar except one person, Abu Bakr, Siddiq, end of story. Yet, the Prophet ﷺ asked Umar, said, when you see Uwais, the person called Uwais, ask him, tell him to make dua for you. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, you know, when he found Uwais, he told him this, خلاص, make dua. He said, and he's making dua for you? He said, yes, this is what the Prophet ﷺ commanded me. خلاص, I'm obeying his command. See, this shows you, this is something permissible to say, أخي, make dua. It's permissible, it's no problem. But depending on that, no. You depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you make your own dua. But it's good for if someone says for another brother, you know, make dua, it is permissible, just like this hadith where the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ commanded Umar to ask Uwais to do dua. And by the way, why did Uwais, he was supposed to be a companion, but he did not meet the Prophet? Why? Yes, mashallah, yes, yes. He was busy with his mother. And did the Prophet ﷺ said that he was lacking because of this? No. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, appreciating this, that he took care of his mother, said, no, ask Uwais to make dua for you. So this shows you that taking care of your parents, subhanAllah, this prevented him from traveling, migrating to the Prophet ﷺ and seeing him because he followed the commands of the Prophet ﷺ. See, if you truly love someone, loving him is not by showing affection. No, loving is by obeying his commands. You love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obey Allah. You love the Prophet ﷺ, where are you from his sunnah? True love is not just saying, Rasulullah, and crying. True love is following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. This is true love, okay? And if you want an example of true love, look at the companions. One of them, like Amr ibn As, who at his time, you know the story that he used to do a lot of siyam and qiyam. And then the Prophet ﷺ told him, look, your body has right on you and your wife has a right on you. So khalas, just fast 3 days. And they said, I can do more than that. They said, okay, fast. You know, it kept on increasing. And the same thing with qiyam. So Amr ibn al-As, he continued on doing a lot of qiyam and a lot of siyam. When he became older, he still maintained that level of worship. They told him why. Plus, you're old now, you cannot. Even he was tired. He said, no, I'm too ashamed to leave something that I was doing at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. After his death, I leave it? Even though he had an excuse, he said, no, I'm not that kind of person. This is true love. This is loving the Prophet ﷺ. Yani, whether he was alive or not, they followed his sunnah. They followed his sunnah. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. And then we have an important principle. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Yani, if you don't memorize the Surah Tabarak, this verse should be memorized. This verse should be memorized and understood and should be in your mind 24/7, 7 days a week. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So end of the day, Allah created death and created life for a cause. Why? For us to compete in doing something. Whom amongst you will have the best of deeds? And you will find some of the early scholars of the Salaf saying that Allah did not say whom amongst you will have the most of deeds, but the best of deeds. And they mention this, as Ibn Kathir mentions this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lam yaqul aktharukum amala, who will have the most deeds, because it's not about doing a lot of actions. What's the point of doing a lot of actions if they were not according to the sunnah? Doing small amounts with sincerity, following the sunnah, this will have a lot of barakah in it. It will be multiplied, alhamdulillah, and it will bring you, will aid you, and bring you more good deeds. Doing a lot of good deeds based on ignorance away from the sunnah, you're wasting your time. It might not be valid, subhanallah. End of the day, you did not benefit anything. So, the best of deeds, they said, the best of deeds based on two criterions: sincerity and following the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yeah, al-ikhlas wal-mutaba'a. You guys might be thinking this is ABC of Islam. We all know this, but you'll be amazed how many people make mistake regarding these two things: sincerity and following the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sincerity is not, okay, all Muslims are sincere. If they were talking about the basic level of sincerity, all Muslims are sincere. They always say, La ilaha illallah. But no, sincerity is also levels. Sincerity is levels. And the higher the level it is, subhanallah, the more taqwa you have, the more your good deeds will be heavy and accepted. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. To test you. So this whole life, life and death is a test. No matter what happens to you, it did not happen by accident. يَا أَخِي, I had this problem with my wife. I had this problem with my child. يَا أَخِي, something bad happened to me, between me and my neighbor, between me and my boss at work. This is all a test. Everything that happens is a test. You are tested with this. Your whole life, your death is a test. What are you going to do in that situation? People think that the test is only doing salah, doing sunnah. No. Test is always, sometimes even how you deal with people. Sometimes you might be having a problem with someone who's related to you, very sensitive matter. How are you going to do? How are you going to react? This is a test from Allah. It's difficult. Especially that person who's older than you have to respect, but he's wrong and he's forcing you to do something. Okay, you have to respect him. This is a test. You have to follow the sunnah. At the same time, subhanAllah, you should not do something that is haram. So it's a test. How you treat your wife, even though, subhanAllah, she might be lacking, she might not be giving you your rights, you're supposed to give her her rights. So it's a test again. How you treat your children, how you deal with them. You don't have time, but you try your best. Again, it's a test. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions some of His great verses and signs, some of His great signs of creation. الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا. Seven heavens, okay, layers, levels, on top of each other. مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَانِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ. If you look at Allah's creation, there is no inconsistency. Everything is, subhanAllah, perfected. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, فَرْجِعِلْنَا الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَوْطٍ مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَوْتٍ فَرْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُطُورٍ فُطُور, here some of the Salaf said, do you find any gaps in Allah's creation? We look at the heavens. It is perfected. Allah created it in a certain way for us to ponder and look. Allah is saying, do you find any flaws in this? We do not find any flaws. Do you find any gaps? You do not find any gaps. Everyone who looks at the heavens, who looks at the stars, is always amazed. Whether he's a believer, whether he's a disbeliever, he's an atheist, they all look at the stars and they're all amazed. Everyone is amazed. And this is a clear sign. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, look again at the stars. Look again. ثُمَّ ارْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِيًا وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ. Even you keep on looking, you return your sight, you try to look again, you, subhanAllah, your eyesight become weak and fatigued, you still don't find any flaws. So this is a clear sign. Everyone can see, everyone can witness. It should lead us to a question, who has perfected this? Who has made it the way that it is? The precision of this system of stars, okay? Who has made it the way that it is? It is Allah. The greatness, this is just a mere creature of Allah's creatures for us to ponder and look at its beauty. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us more about this sign. وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. So Allah decorated it, beautified it, its beauty, it's beautiful, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to look at. It's decorated, and it's also for a specific cause, which is رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. It throws the devils. Okay, it strikes the devils. Why does it strike the devils? Why is it rujum al shayateen? Why will the devils aslan go to the heavens? To enter? Yes, okay, they want the news of the heavens, yeah? They were allowed, at some point it was possible for them, but before the revelation, before the Prophet ﷺ was sent, khalas, it stopped. It's guarded. And anyone who tries will be shut down, yeah? So it's protected. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we mentioned that the shayateen here, who are they? What are they? They're made out of fire? You said made out of fire? Yes? Okay, min marijin min nar, yes. Well, what are they? They're jinn. They are jinn, yeah? So here, وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَعْتَدْنَا لَهُمْ عَذَابَ السَّعِيرِ. We have prepared for them, the punishment of the fire. So these are disbelieving jinn. When you see devils, shayateen, they are disbelieving jinn. Because jinn are there Muslim jinn, and there's kafir, which is disbeliever jinn. They're the shayateen. أَذِي وَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. Yeah? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talked about their torment, their punishment of the jinn, those who disbelieved, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mentioned the torment of the disbelieving ins. He said, وَلِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمْ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. Okay, what is the punishment for those who disbelieved? عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمْ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes some things about hellfire. إِذَا أُلْقُوا فِيهَا سَمِعُوا لَهَا شَهِيقًا وَهِيَ تَفُورٌ. So when they're thrown, so they'll be thrown into hellfire, they hear from hellfire screams, okay? إِذَا أُلْقُوا فِيهَا سَمِعُوا لَهَا شَهِيقًا. شَهِيق, is it scream? Is it a scream or is it the inhaling of hellfire? Opinions. So here they said it's inhaling of the hellfire. وَهِيَ تَفُورُ, while it's boiling. SubhanAllah. Yani hellfire is a creature. You know this. Hellfire is a creature. It inhales, it breathes. And when it inhales, nothing, subhanAllah, everything about hellfire is scary. Even when it inhales, it, subhanAllah, it makes this great sound. سمعوا لها الزفير وهي تفور. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تكاد تميز من الغيظ. تميز من التمايز. So from its anger, so it's a creature, from its extreme anger, it almost splits up. It almost splits up from its anger. So it's extremely angry. It bursts with rage. It almost bursts with rage. تكاد تميز من الغيظ. So it's extremely angry. Okay? And every time, look at this. Whenever a crowd, a group of people are thrown, كلما, so it's repeated. Every time a group of people are thrown into hellfire, سألهم خزنتها ألم يأتكم نذير. This is very important. Very important. Whenever a group is thrown into hellfire, they will be asked by who خزنتها. Who are خزنت, the keepers? Who are the keepers of hellfire? What does it mean, keepers of hellfire? Who are the keepers?
Angels.
Huh? Angels? Yes. Does anyone know some of the description of these angels? They are described. What? Okay, it's scary, but everything in hellfire is scary. But specific description mentioned. Angels are made of nur. Yes, this is no exception. But the angels of hellfire now, you know their description. Huh? Yeah, okay. Okay, obviously they never smile. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ. غلاظ شداد. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم. Okay, لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم. غلاظ شداد. And here some of the scholars said, mercy was not even created in their hearts. Every creature, he has some mercy in his heart. No matter how evil he is, he has some mercy. Those angels of hellfire, mercy was not created in their hearts. They don't know what mercy is. Because they'll be commanded with commands, they'll be tormenting. Their job will be tormenting. And they look different. They don't look like the normal angels. Yeah, everything in hellfire, subhanAllah, is a torment for its people. So as they say, they don't smile, obviously they're going to be there to torment. So they'll be asking the people in hellfire, those who'll be entering, they'll be asking the same questions. So whenever a group comes, أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ نَذِيرٌ. What got you here? Wasn't there a warner? Didn't you guys have a warner who warned you of this heaven? Who warned you of this torment, this punishment? What was the answer? Did they deny? No one denies. There's a hadith here. No one denies. قَالُوا بَلَى قَدْ جَاءَنَا نَذِيرٌ فَكَذَّبْنَا وَقُلْنَا مَا نَزَّلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ كَبِيرٍ. So they disbelieved. They disbelieved. So when they asked them, did you find a warner? Did you get a warner? Someone who warned you of this? They said, yes, بَلَى قَدْ جَاءَنَا. A warner came to us. Whether they were at the same time of the Prophet or after him, end of the day, this Quran is a warner. They were warned. But they disbelieved. And they said, no, Allah did not send anyone. Allah did not send anything. But look at that. Then after this, they say, وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا. Look, subhanAllah, one of these important verses. وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلْ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. If we really listened carefully with our hearts, wanting to benefit, or if we used our rationale, if we really thought about it, we would have saved ourselves. Brothers, we're reading these verses now. And this is something that's going to happen in hellfire. People will say, Ya akhi, if we really paid attention, if we really listened to revelation and obeyed, if we really thought about it carefully, Ya akhi, these overwhelming signs and believed, we wouldn't have been here in hellfire. فَاعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِ. Yes. Okay. فَاعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ. They admit their sins. And the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, لَا يَدْخُلْ أَحَدُ النَّارِ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّارَ أَوْلَى بِهِ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. Subhanallah. No one will be entering hellfire except that he will know at that time, at that day, in the day of judgment, he will know that he is more deserving of hellfire than paradise. Because khalas, when he sees these signs, day of judgment, You know, the angels, he knows that, subhanAllah, he has done something big by disbelieving. He has, and he knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with him. He knows that he has done something extremely terrible. He knows that he's more deserving of hellfire than of paradise. Everyone who will be entering hellfire will understand, will know that he's more deserving of hellfire than paradise. Subhanallah. وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلْ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. Subhanallah. فَاَعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ فَسُحْقًا لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. Subhanallah. Okay. They confessed. What value does this confession have? What? خلاص, it's too late. After death, it is too late. Every single one of us now, if he repents to Allah, inshallah, his repentance will be accepted. He has a chance. He can do good. You can say subhanallah. You can pray 2 units. You still have the chance to improve yourself. You still have the chance to correct your way. You still have the chance to make a big difference. But we don't know what's going to happen, you know, 1 second after now. Nobody knows. Are we going to be leaving this masjid? Allahu a'lam. How many times have you seen people lecturing and then they fall down? How many times you see people praying and then they fall down? On their way, trying to go, so then they collapse, subhanAllah, and die. You don't know when your end is. So now is the chance to make a difference. Khalas, change your hearts. Don't be like the examples that Allah subhanahu has given us. This is something. Allah is telling us about hellfire. This is something as if it happened. This is something that's going to happen. People will be entering hellfire. The angels will be telling them, wasn't there a warner for you? I said, yes, there was a warner. We disbelieved. And they said, if we listened and if we really paid attention and looked with our hearts, we would have been of the believers. They admitted, they confessed, but it had no value. سُحْقًا لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. Subhanallah, beautiful verse. Indeed, إِنَّ مُؤَكَّدَ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ, they fear their Lord, بالغيب. We did not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we have the news of the hereafter. We have the news of our Creator, and we believe in our Creator. We did not see Him. This is believing in the unseen. Believing in Allah is part of believing the world of unseen. We worship Him, even though we did not see Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in Him. We ask His aid. We make dua. We ask Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet we do not see Him. يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ. And بِالْغَيْبِ also could mean when nobody sees you. You're alone in a room. Subhanallah, nobody sees you, nobody cares about you, nobody's looking at what you're doing. And then you make dhikr of Allah, you make dua, you worship Allah in a place that nobody sees you, nobody hears you, but Allah. This is believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is knowing that Allah sees you and you fear Him. You can do the haram, nobody will know. Allah knows and that's enough. Allah knows and that's enough. Khalas. This is why these days it's a test, subhanAllah. We're walking around and the access to haram is very easy. These days it's in our mobile phones. Even if you have nothing to do with these things, you get advertisements. The haram is very easy and nobody can know. In your own room, people might be looking at haram, seeing haram, listening to haram. Fear Allah. If you fear Allah and you do it for the sake of Allah, you leave the haram for the sake of Allah. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ. Remember this verse, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبُّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ. What? لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. A great reward and forgiveness. You will get forgiveness for the mistakes that you have done. And you will get not just any reward, a great reward. If the shaitan comes to you and whispers to you at times of heedlessness, you know, you didn't do much dhikr, you just woke up or at time you want to sleep, shaitan comes to you, he's like, open the phone, look at this, look at that. And one thing leads to another. Remember this verse. If you fear Allah, you stop, be brave. You stop at that instance and you say, no, Allah is looking at me now. And I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will do this for the sake of Allah. Your heart will change. You will get forgiveness. You will get ajrun kabir. You will get forgiveness. You will be getting ajrun kabir. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that regardless of what you do and what you say, whether people see, if you conceal your speech or publicize, Allah knows what you do and knows what's in your heart. وَأَسِرُّوا قَوْلَكُمْ أَوْ اجْهَرُوا بِهِ. Doesn't matter. Allah knows everything. إِنَّهُ عَلِيمُ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. Allah knows about what you're thinking, what you're planning to do. Even those small thoughts that come into your heart, Allah knows about them. Allah knows about them. Sometimes, subhanAllah, you might be thinking about haram. You didn't do anything, but you're thinking. Do say astaghfirullah. Allah sees you. And these, by the way, this train of thoughts, it starts with a thought. Nobody does haram instantly. It starts with a thought. If you do not protect yourself from this thought will grow. It's a seed. It will grow to a tree. And then you'll find yourself, you're doing some actions following that thought. That's why Ibn Qayyim says that these small thoughts, if you do not pay attention to them, it's like you're just taking matchsticks and lighting them and throwing them down. Some of them might be burned, some of them might be go off, some of them might cause a fire. So these thoughts that you have of haram, you should protect yourself and stop and do dhikr. Otherwise, they will lead you to something haram. You don't say, no, these are harmless thoughts. How many harmless thoughts led to major sins? Be careful. Don't, follow these thoughts. As I said, they're like, lighting matchstick. And then you're throwing them down. There's a chance that it will go off. There's a chance it will cause a fire and burn you down. So protect yourself from these thoughts. وَأَسِرُّوا قَوْلَكُمْ أَوْ اجْهَرُوا بِهِ إِنَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقُ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Does he not know? Does the one who created not know? SubhanAllah, of course he knows. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقُ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. And then he mentions some of the signs and his favors upon us. هُوَ الَّذِي جَعْلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ ذَلُولًا فَامْشُوا فِي مَنَاكِبِهَا وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورِ. Here in this verse, okay, he's the one who made this earth livable. Okay, we're able to live on it because of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made. So, and also, وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ. Pay attention. وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ. Whose rizq are we eating from? Allah's rizq. Whatever rizq, whatever provision that you get, it's from Allah. Alhamdulillah. Any blessing that comes to you, this is from Allah. It didn't happen by accident. You didn't get that raise by accident or because of your hard work. It was from Allah. That job you got, it's not because of your degree. It's not because of your work experience. It was a rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But by using this for His sake, وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ. Anything, any provision that you get is from Allah. So always start with Bismillah. And when you finish, you say Alhamdulillah. Praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورِ. And remind yourself that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be resurrected. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those who feel secure, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you a warning. أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضِ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورِ. So how do you feel secure? SubhanAllah, even though, don't think that since I'm okay and people around me are in sins, that you're secured. Do you not fear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who holds authority in the heavens, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would not cause the earth to swallow you? Just like what happened to the past nations, some nations were swallowed under the ground. So do you not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you too secured? What's protecting you from this? This could happen to you. أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورُ. أَمْ أَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يُرْسِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حَاصِبًا. حَاصِبًا is a torment from above. Okay? The first torment from below you. The earth opens up, splits up and eats you, buries you. The other one, torment from the heavens. أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضِ أَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ يُرْسِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حَاصِبًا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ كَيْفَ نَذِيرٌ. Then you will know Allah's warning. SubhanAllah. فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ كَيْفَ نَذِيرٌ. So never feel secured. You see, this is important. People don't realize that they should always, you always say, you should be between hope and fear. Hope, we hope for Allah's mercy. We hear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, al-Ghafir, al-Ghafar, al-Ghafur. We hope for Allah's mercy, of course. Why not? We ask for Allah's mercy, and you're commanded to ask for Allah's mercy and Allah's forgiveness. But you never feel secure. You never say, oh, Allah will forgive me. Khalas, I always make dua, Allah will forgive me. Here, that means you're in danger. If that was the case, then remember these verses. Aamintum man fis sama? Yeah? Ayakhsifu bikum al-ard? Aamintum man fis sama? Ayursil alaykum hasiba? Subhanallah, fear Allah. Fearing Allah is a worship by itself. And how did the messengers worship Allah? Just by love and, or was it both? Fear and hope and love. Fear and hope, yeah? See, the complete worship is combining two things. Hope for Allah's mercy. Hope for the reward of your deeds. Fear of your sins. Yaqi, we make a lot of sins. And you're not being realistic. You're naive if you're saying, I'm the person who does not sin. Ay, if you're saying this, that means you're the person who's in real danger. We all make sins. We all make mistakes, especially those who are aware of it. At least, alhamdulillah, they know their mistakes. But those who are not aware, and this is a problem. There should be a wake-up call. You should wake yourself up from the sleep that you're in. So we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and fearing Allah is a worship in itself. Fearing Allah is a worship in itself. So here, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, look at the past nations. Look at the past nations. وَلَقَدْ كَذَّبَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَكَيْفَ كَانَ نَكِيرٌ. It's a question. Okay. So how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deal with the past nations? Allah mentions in the Quran how they were destroyed. Some of them were destroyed by a hurricane, by wind. Some of them were by a loud shout from the heavens. They were destroyed. Some of them were buried. Some of them drowned. These nations, they messed with Allah. They crossed the boundaries, and Allah dealt with them accordingly. So don't think that, you know your limits. Look, we're mere servants of Allah. Allah does not need us. We need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Messengers feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah with love and fear. And they know Allah more than anyone else. Messengers, they feared Allah. Why? Because Allah should be feared. They feared Allah because Allah should be feared. The messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all other messengers, they feared Allah. They worshipped Allah with love and fear. Okay? وَلَقَدْ كَذَّبَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَكَيْفَ كَانَ مَكِينَ أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ فَوْقَهُمْ. Okay, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, of his signs, will they not look at the birds above them with wings? This is a sign. How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create them the way that he did, making them float and fly in the heavens, subhanallah. Their bones, their structure, everything was for a cause. أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ فَوْقَهُمْ صَافَّاتٍ وَيَقْبِضْ مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَنِ. Allah made these causes, created them the way that they are. And if you look at them, how their structures, subhanAllah, they're varying in weights and sizes, yet they all fly, they glide, they fly differently. This design, who designed it? And many of the planes that we have, they imitated the design of these birds and bats, and yeah, because it's an intelligent design. It shows you that someone did design it. It did not happen by accident. It was design. It shows you intelligence. It was by a creator who's alim, who's hakim. Subhanallah. أَمَّنْ هَذَا الَّذِي هُوَ جُنْدٌ لَكُمْ يَنصُرُكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ الرَّحْمَنِ إِنِ الْكَافِرُونَ إِلَّا فِي غُرُورٍ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, for those who worshipped other than Allah with him, which army will protect you from Allah? Which army will aid you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to punish you, destroy you? Which army? The past nations were stronger than us. The past nations had more bigger armies than anyone here. And physically, they were created different, okay? Their size, what they can endure. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them without any effort. So we're nothing. No matter how big your armies are, look at what happens now. One earthquake, no matter what technology you have, it destroys everything. One hurricane, they keep saying, we wish it goes left or right. It goes straight. If it enters, no one can defend. You cannot do anything. It doesn't matter how technologically advanced you are. You cannot do anything. So, which army will protect you, will avail you against Allah? No one, okay? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the disbelievers are not but in delusion. They're deluded. Okay, they don't understand what they're dealing with. And again, your rizq, your provision. أَفَمَنْ هَذَا أَمَّنْ هَذَا الَّذِي يَرْزُقُكُمْ إِنْ أَمْسَكَ رِزْقَهُ بَلْ لَجُّ فِي عُتُوٍ وَنُفُورٍ. So, and again, who will provide for you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stops and prevents? No one. No one, even if the whole world, the jinn and ins, they want to aid you and give you wealth, give you something that Allah Azza wa Jalla has stopped, no one can give it to you, okay? That's why end of the day, it's the command of Allah. Khalas, ya akhi, shortcut, go to Allah. Don't go left and right and subhanAllah, khalas. One, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu gave us an example of a person who understands that this is from Allah, that this world is a test. You should believe in Allah, worshipping Allah, doing the right thing in this dunya. أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ أَهْدَىٰ أَمَّا يَمْشِي سَوِيًّا عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. So, who is, which example is better for you? Which example do you want to follow? An example of a man walking on his feet, going straight, or a person walking on his face, not seeing where he's going, going left and right. Which is an example you want to follow? This is this example of a believer and disbeliever. Of a person following the signs of Allah, going the right path, and a person who has no idea what this world is about, and just going left and right, walking on his face. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us many examples of this. In Surah Hud, مَثَلُ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ كَالْأَعْمَى وَالْأَصَمْ وَالسَّمِيعِ وَالْبَصِيرِ. In Surah Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the example of the two, that the believers and disbelievers are like those who are deaf and blind and those who see and hear. Same thing. This is the difference between light and day and night, yani, subhanAllah, between guidance and misguidance. قُلْ هُوَ الَّذِي أَنْشَأَكُمْ وَجَعَلَ لَكُمْ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. SubhanAllah, this chapter, wallahi, if you look at this, verse by verse, it's like filled with principles for your whole life. That's why you find the important chapters of the Qur'an, the sunnah is to recite them every day. Like this chapter, the sunnah to recite it every night. Why? Because it will protect you from the torment of the grave and because of the benefits. It's not because of the ajr, the reward only, because when you recite this, you're reminded. You're reminded of these things. SubhanAllah. Now every time you recite or you listen, you remind these things. SubhanAllah. You're reminded of these things. Look at this. قُلْ هُوَ الَّذِي أَنْشَأَكُمْ وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ. Okay. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for you the hearing, vision and hearts. Here the hearts, al-afida, they say when you contemplate, when you think, it's not just the brain, it's connected. It's the brain and the heart. Okay, that's why al-aql, when they say al-aql, you know this, it was mentioned, al-aql, they say, aql is not here, it's here. It's the heart, they're connected, the heart and brain. You don't think with your head, no, it's both the heart and the brain. That's why here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they translated it as hearts, but as-sama', hearing and vision, and the heart, which is the tool of contemplating and thinking. These three things were given to you from Allah by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these three things? How do you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the eyesight, you know, for your hearing? How do you thank Allah?
Not seeing anything haram and not listening.
Okay, not, but also using them.
Worshipping.
Yeah, worshipping, yeah. Yes. It's good that you're with us. Huh? What do you say?
Thanking.
Yeah, okay, Jazakallah khair, yes. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by using this to contemplate and ponder upon the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, the signs. The signs are two types, yeah? We have religious signs, which is the Qur'an and Sunnah. The Qur'an is clearly for us to use our eyes to read, our ears to listen to this, so that we can think, and then we think with our hearts. So all these three things, we use them when reading the Qur'an, when listening to the Qur'an. When you listen to the Qur'an, Allah speaks about the heavens, you use your eyes and look. This is how you thank, you know, these blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the brother mentioned, you do not use them for haram. And actually, you know what? In many verses, we hear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the disbelievers as being blind, deaf. Why? They have eyesight. Why does Allah call them blind? Deaf. Why does Allah call them deaf?
Even their ayahs, they're not listening.
It's as if they don't have the eyesight. If you're not using your eyesight for what Allah has created you for, if you're not using your hearing for what Allah has created it for, if you're not using your heart and brain for what Allah has created for, it's as if you don't have these things. It's as if it's a complete waste on you. That's why Allah calls them, يعني صمم بكم عمي sometimes. فهم لا يرجعون, they don't go back. فهم لا يعقلون, Surah Al-Baqarah twice. لا يعقلون, they don't understand. They don't understand this faith. They don't believe because it's not that they're stupid. They have, but their stupidity in terms of not taking advantage and not pondering upon this. And they're going to be the ones who are going to be blaming themselves in hellfire, saying, if we listened, if we pondered and thought about it, we would have made it. It was clear. What stopped us? Yes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ هُوَ الَّذِي ذَرَأَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. Okay, it is He who has multiplied you, okay. And to Him you are gathered. Hashr, so you'll be gathered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَقُولُونَ ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين. This is what, out of mockery, of course, disbelievers, they always mock. You say, okay, okay. You say there's a hereafter. Fine. When is the hereafter? خلاص. Bring the hereafter. You say we're there. Allah promised the torment. يلا يلا. Bring the torment. يلا. عذبنا. يلا. Send stones from the heavens. This is what they say. They mock. They take this lightly. It's a joke for them. It's a joke. Subhanallah. We find this even these days. Yeah. Okay. Where's Allah's torment? يلا. Where's Allah's torment? This is what they say. Subhanallah. يعني. How much will they regret these words? ويقول متى هذا الوعد وإن كنتم صادقين. So they say this to the, okay, when is this promise if subhanAllah you were truthful? Look here, it shows you. قل إنما, Allah is saying to the Prophet. It's not even up to the Prophet. Prophets are warners. Messengers, they just warn. The torment is not up to them. They cannot say, oh Allah, خلاص torment. No, it's not up to the messengers, it's up to Allah. You're just a warner. That's it. This is your job. Punishment? Reward? No messenger has anything to do with this. It's up to Allah. قُلْ إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. And this is in many verses. قُلْ إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. The knowledge of this is only with Allah. And I am only a clear warner. In many chapters of the Quran, many of the messengers, they say the exact same thing. Nuh said this when the people said, خلاص, when is the punishment? Hud said, قوم Hud, the exact same thing. Almost all messenger, they say this. خلاص, إنما النذير. نذير. نذير. I'm a warner. Okay? Punishment is not in my hands. It's when Allah decrees. Okay? And then they mock. They say, Allah, you're mocking, you're taking this lightly. Look at the other verse. Look at the next verse. فَلَمَّا رَأَوْهُ زُلْفَةً سِيئَتْ وُجُوهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُ وَقِيلَ هَذَا الَّذِي كُنْتُمْ بِتَدْعُونَ. So when they see, when the hereafter starts, now the shock starts. Okay, oh. What's happening? Now they start to remember. Yes, there was a warner before. They start remembering. Yes, they were religions. Yes, they were messengers. Yes, there were people who were following messengers and there were people who were fighting those messengers. فَلَمَّا رَأُوهُ زُلْفَةً سِيئَتْ وُجُوهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا خَلَاصْ. On their faces, it shows that they're seeing a problem. And then it is said to them, as they used to mock in the dunya, they're mocked in the akhirah. It said to them, قِيلَ هَذَا الَّذِي كُنْتُمْ بِهِ تَدْعُونَ. You were rushing Allah's punishment? This is Allah's punishment. يلا. Subhanallah. يعني, it's something very scary. And in some verses, أَفَسِحْرٌ هَذَا. What? You claim that it's magic? Okay, now when they see the torment, is this magic? يعني, it's extremely shocking, صراحة. يعني, Allah protect us. يعني, it's... What they mocked in this dunya, they took it lightly, then they're surprised with it. And you can't imagine the shock that they'll be having, subhanAllah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ أَسَيَا وَمَسْنِجَ بَاللَّهِ أَرَأَيْتُ مِنْ أَهْلَكَنِيَا اللَّهُ إِنْ أَهْلَكَنِيَا اللَّهُ وَمَنْ مَعِيَا أَوْ رَحِمَنَا. Okay. So, end of the day, because they used to say, خلاص, يعني if we wait, we're patient until that messenger dies, and then خلاص, the revelation will die with him. This is what they used to say. But Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying here, is telling them, it's not about the messenger and the companions. Even if they die, who's going to protect you from Allah's torment and, you know, So do something. Don't worry about the messenger. Don't worry about the companions. He's saying them. Worry about yourselves. Don't worry about these people. Believe, protect yourself. It's not about the messenger. It's not just groups. We're fighting one group. It's about yourselves. We're something much greater than this. So worry about yourselves. Believe and worship for your own sake, not because of the messenger or the companions. Yeah. Either case, if Allah Azza wa Jal took us or He had mercy on us, who is going to protect you from Allah's punishment if you do not believe? Okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ سَيْهُ هُوَ الرَّحْمَانُ وَآمَنَّا بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْهُ فِي الضَّلَالِ مُبِينَ. Very important. And we find in others, فَاعْبُدْهُ وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَيْهِ. You worship Allah, but you also depend on Allah. You depend on Allah. You will not achieve the high levels of faith except if you depend on Allah. Tawakkul, trust in Allah. Trust in Allah. So you act on causes and then you depend on Allah that Allah will accept my deed. You depend on Allah to aid you. You depend on Allah to guide you. You do your job and then you depend on Allah. You don't depend. And there is no tawakkul without taking action. You cannot say, I'm depending on Allah, and you're sitting down. You're not doing worship. You're not doing anything. You say, I'm depending on Allah. No, you're not. You're not depending on Allah. You're taking this as a joke. If you're not acting on causes and you're saying tawakkul, that's not tawakkul. Tawakkul is depending on Allah after acting on causes. Whether it's worldly causes or religious causes. Religious causes for the Jannah. Worldly causes, you want to have children, you have to get married. You don't say, I'm going to get children without getting married. You're going to say, this is not the same person. Yeah, I want to find a job, you're sitting at home. Yeah, go look for a job. Look for a job, okay? Act on causes. You make dua, yes, that's causes. But also go and search. Talk to people. And depend on Allah. But depend on Allah. وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ هُوَ فِي الضَّلَالِ مُبِينَ. You will know the hereafter who is misguided. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again saying, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ مِنْ أَصْبَحَ مَاءُكُمْ غَوْرًا فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِمَاءٍ مَعِينَ. This that you depend on the water, which is the source of life for you, what will do, or who will bring it back if it sank away in the ground? Who? فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِمَاءٍ مَعِينَ. Who other than Allah? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, with this, we end this today, inshallah. And next week, inshallah, we'll be starting chapter noon. I will see. We might take another chapter with it. Allahu alam. So this is it for today. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. جزاكم الله خير.